So today, Dr. Scholz, we're talking about a recent update. The FDA has approved a new drug for a PARP inhibitor called Talzenna with Xtandi. And so all new approvals are kind of exciting, but when it comes to a new approval, we have to learn where does this type of treatment take place in the sequencing of prostate cancer, who is it going to be eligible for, will insurance cover it? It opens up a whole different set of questions. So my first question is, can you explain what Xtandi is and then what Talzenna is?
Sure. So this clinical trial looked at a standard FDA-approved medication called Xtandi, which is a second-generation hormonal therapy, with or without a PARP inhibitor, Talzenna, which is a oral medication, which is really a type of chemotherapy. So what they looked at in this clinical trial, there were 800 people in the trial. They randomized people everyone got Xtandi, and half of the people had a Talzenna pill added to the Xtandi. And then they watched these men over a couple of years to determine if the cancer progressed earlier or later, depending on whether or not they got Talzenna. And the trial came back showing that the people that were on the Talzenna chemotherapy had a delay in the time of cancer progression compared to the people that took Xtandi alone. It was pretty black and white finding. Interestingly, the patients who were on the Talzenna treatment didn't have to have specific mutations to benefit. PARP inhibitors have been shown to work really well in people that have mutations such as BRCA or ATM, PALB types of mutations. But even the patients that didn't have these mutations seemed to benefit with the use of it. So to answer your question about what Xtandi is being a second-generation hormonal agent like Zytiga, like Nubeqa, like Erleada. These medicines are very effective for people who've previously been on Lupron-type medicines, and when it stops working, second-generation hormonal medicines can induce a remission. So what I think that what's interesting and not that surprising is that when you combine effective therapies early rather than using them one after the next, you seem to get better results. So instead of giving the Xtandi for a while and then giving the Talzenna later, this particular trial added the Xtandi and the Talzenna up front at the beginning and showed that they did better than patients who took a placebo pill. And I'm not sure, but I think they probably could have crossed over to the Talzenna later if they wanted to. And if that's the case, then the it shows that the upfront use of effective medication is superior to giving things sequentially.
So it seems more and more we're hearing about PARP inhibitors. How exactly does a PARP inhibitor like Talzenna work?
So chemotherapy medicines can hurt normal cells, but they selectively kill cancer cells. They have side effects, of course, which are a little different than the hormonal type medicines. They can cause some nausea, they can cause some fatigue, they can cause some low blood counts, low white counts, low platelet counts, but generally pretty well tolerated. In the study where they gave these Xtandi medicines, about 10% of the patients had to go off of Xtandi, and about 20% of the patients had to go off of the Talzenna. It's not an innocuous treatment. There can be side effects, and in some patients, they don't tolerate it well and they have to stop it.
Before I get to my next question on Talzenna, I just wanted to remind you that we're a nonprofit organization and all of the free videos on this channel come from support from people just like you. If you would like to donate, you can do so at pcri.org/donate. Now back to this video on PARP inhibitors. When we say there's a delay in disease progression, how long is that delay?
Well, they didn't reach the disease where half of the Talzenna treated group had progressed by the time the study had finished. But they did show that the patients that had gone on the Xtandi had developed progression after about 20 months. So it was a statistically significant difference in terms of the interval longer, but I don't know the exact, I don't think we actually have how long the Talzenna group took to progress, and therefore I can't really give you an interval.
So what would be the most common side effects that one's going to experience with the combination of Talzenna with Xtandi?
Number one problem, as often is the case with a variety of different treatments that we give, is fatigue. Study after study, of course, shows that the patients that pursue fitness programs do better and have less fatigue. But tiredness and fatigue is a difficult aspect of many of the treatments, including hormonal therapy and chemotherapy.
I know in other types of treatments, you know, sometimes you have to watch blood count and other things like that. Are there any secondary concerns that the patient should be aware of?
Yes. One issue with chemotherapy that's different, of course, is the possibility of low white count, low red count, low platelet count. I'll explain what that means briefly. But what's interesting with the PARP inhibitors, Talzenna being one of those, is that hair loss is not very common. So that's at least one aspect or good news that's related to this type of chemotherapy. When you look at the other injection types of chemo that we use, such as Gemtana and Taxotere, hair loss is occurring in more than 50% of those patients. But low blood counts is probably a pretty universal issue with all types of chemotherapy, and there are ways to compensate for that. There are medicines that build up the red count. For example, if a low red count is the same thing as having anemia, men do get a little bit of anemia when they go on hormone therapy, and they can get even more severe anemia when they're on any type of chemotherapy. So in the worst case scenario, they could even need a transfusion, but more commonly, medicines such as Aranesp or Epigen are administered subcutaneously. These are injections every week or two to build up the red count. Low white blood cell counts, if they get serious, can cause infections. And there are medicines such as Neulasta, another form of subcutaneous injection, that can build up the white count and prevent infections. Low platelet counts, platelets are the aspect of the blood that helps blood coagulate normally. Low platelet counts, when serious, could predispose to bleeding. And there are no really effective medicines. There are medicines, but they're not practical ones to build up platelet counts. So those numbers need to be watched when people are taking Talzenna to make sure that they're not dropping too low. Sometimes you have to reduce the dose of the Talzenna or even stop it altogether for a period of time. Perhaps use some of these secondary medicines, such as Neulasta or Aranesp, to build up the counts. This is why these medicines more commonly are going to be given by oncologists rather than urologists. Urologists manage a lot of advanced prostate cancer, but they're surgeons, and typically they're not that conversant in managing blood counts on a regular basis. This is the domain of a medical oncologist, and ongoing monitoring is essential.
When it comes to drugs like this, you know, I know you mentioned lightly the stage that it's in, but can you clarify as far as it's approved in this stage and we're hoping to see it's maybe going to come forth in this stage, we need to know exactly where the patient can get it.
I already alluded briefly to the fact that there's sort of a sequencing mindset in the cancer world, and there's reasons for that. This is where you'll give one medicine, it stops working. You'll give another medicine, it stops working. You'll give a third medicine. And that's practical, especially if the situation's not too serious. In more serious cases, we don't want medicines to run out. We want to actually attack the cancer up front. So in this particular trial, they had patients who had become hormone resistant to, say, Lupron or to Orgovyx or to Firmagon. And PSAs were rising. In some cases, these patients had already been given some chemotherapy, not all of them, but some of them had had some previous Taxotere. And then in that scenario, after the Lupron stopped working, we call that androgen-independent prostate cancer, and some cases rather severe forms if they'd had previous chemo, those individuals then were put on a combination of Xtandi plus Talzenna or Xtandi plus a placebo. And it's a androgen-independent prostate cancer with metastatic disease that's progressing. What's a little unusual in many of my patients is that we won't wait for patients to become androgen-independent before we start them on a second-generation hormonal agent. If people have serious disease or metastatic disease, studies now show that you don't want to give the medicine sequentially. You want to give them in combination up front, and you're going to get better outcomes overall. So I'm not seeing as many of these patients who've been followed sequentially on Lupron for a period of years become resistant. And then, and this is the profile of the people in this clinical trial where they were given Talzenna plus Xtandi. That's the role that it's FDA approved for. And I think the question will come in patients who have metastatic disease at the get-go, hormone-sensitive disease. Now we're giving Xtandi right up front with the Lupron and oftentimes with Taxotere. The question would be maybe that Talzenna would be a good substitute for the Taxotere. It's probably a little better tolerated. It's a pill. And can this be advanced into the earlier stages? This study doesn't address that question, but it's a logical next step.
So we have other PARP inhibitors in the prostate space. You know, we have olaparib and rucaparib. So how do they compare to something like Talzenna?
We don't have any head-to-head comparison trials. I think medical oncologists in general are assuming that these are fairly interchangeable medications. Olaparib and rucaparib, I don't believe have approval for patients who are that don't have the genetic defects that I talked about earlier. There are studies that have shown ineffectiveness of PARP inhibitors when patients don't have those specific genetic mutations. But the category of patients may not be the same, and I don't think there's any convincing evidence that there's a big difference between these different medicines. But there may be differences in terms of how insurance companies are going to pay for them, because they get approval in a designated area or stage of prostate cancer. So it's nice that we have all these products available to us now. I think they have undoubted effectiveness in patients that do have these mutations. And now with this new PARP inhibitor being approved for men that don't have genetic mutations, that broadens the appeal a little bit.
So this leads me to kind of a broader question. We have some patients who may have failed Lupron, now they're on Zytiga, and they may be wondering, if I'm on Zytiga or maybe darolutamide, is Talzenna an option for me, or do I have to switch to Xtandi in order to get access to the Talzenna?
From a purely medical point of view, I would be comfortable giving Talzenna with Zytiga. The interesting thing will be how closely is this scrutinized by the insurance companies. These medicines are rather expensive, and it may turn out that the insurance companies will specify that they want this particular Xtandi plus Talzenna combination. But I don't see any reason why it couldn't be used in combination with Zytiga.
Well, thank you for clarifying this, Dr. Scholz. And also thank you for mentioning that, you know, patients need to see a medical oncologist for this. I think a lot of times when patients are going to urologists and maybe they get on a hormone therapy, they're not recognizing that chemo is such an important part of this. And especially as you mentioned, early chemo, and the earlier the better. I think now that we have Talzenna and these PARP inhibitors, it's exciting that we have kind of a new arrow in the quiver when it comes to doctors being able to treat prostate cancer. But now the combination of those treatments, it sounds like it's exciting. And it's also the concept that we can combine these therapies with other things in the future. So this is kind of a new wave of treatment being rolled out, and it's exciting to see. So thank you for explaining that. So today we talked about a new PARP inhibitor, Talzenna, in combination with an existing hormone therapy that we've had in prostate cancer for over a decade called Xtandi. It's super exciting when we come into these situations and we have combination therapies that are now approved, FDA approved for these types of situations. So speaking of the situation itself, it's really good to know your particular stage. If you think that you're a candidate, it's really good to come to your doctors and say, hey, have you heard of this? If you would like to print out more information about Talzenna, you can do so in the link below in the description of this video. But when you come to your doctor, you can say, you know, hey, have you heard of this? Am I a candidate? What are the ins and outs for my specific case? And also, if you need help preparing for that conversation, you can contact our helpline. They are prostate cancer patients who are educated in these things, and they can help you really refine your questions so that you have better conversations with your medical team. Better conversations, better communication equals better outcomes. Also, the other thing is, if you're going to go on a treatment like this where it is a combination therapy with a chemo-like drug mixed with a hormone therapy, I would really encourage you to make a game plan specifically for your side effects. Know ahead of time if you need to prepare for certain things. We want to make sure that you are taking care of the entire process, not just focusing on the cancer and treating it, but also focusing, as you've heard me say before, I'm sure, on your quality of life. The whole cancer process, from the concept of being diagnosed, going to doctor's appointments, the travel, the cost, now having a treatment, but also having the side effects, is a lot of distress. If you can mitigate as many side effects as possible and alleviate some of that distress, we really believe that that's the best option. So please think of all of those things in mind. Please take care of your emotional health, your mental health, talk to people, get into a support group, call our helpline if you need support. We are here for you. Thank you so much for trusting us. Please remember, you're not alone. If you would like more information about anything else that we can do, you can visit us at pcri.org. And thank you so much.